Rev up your engines! All right, with the price of used car sky high, this lady bought this protege when it was a year and a half old from Hertz Rental Car for about $8,000. Got a new job where she's got to drive from Kentucky to Nashville every day. She wants to see, is it still going to be dependable, or should she look elsewhere? And I'm going to tell her the truth. All the pieces are still there. Mind you, the paint's fading away. That's typical with these. They didn't paint the clear coat right, and it's all fading off. Realize she bought this thing for around $8,000. 25,000 miles. She has 186,000 miles on it. She certainly got her money's worth out of it so far. Is it going to be dependable in the future? We're going to find out yay or nay here. She lost the hubcap, so she put the good ones on one side. That's a little bash. Doesn't make it run any different. There's no hubcaps on this side. Now that happened 10 years ago, so obviously it's had to affect the running of the car. These were made as economy cars to go from here to there. As you can see on the hood, this is a 2-liter four-cylinder. Unfortunately, it does have a timing belt, so you got to change the timing belts every once in a while. It's no race car, but it has 130 horsepower, a lot more than the original 68. And yes, it's an older car. It's a 2002. So it gets 28 miles a gallon on the highway. Not great gas mileage, but typical for that age for a 2-liter engine. Now, Mazda's always made pretty good engines. This one's still going pretty strong. Sounds perfectly fine. Got a tiny bit of valve clatter, but you're gonna hear that on a car. This does have hydraulic lifters, and they're working good enough. But on this 02, it's the automatic transmission that's the weak point. You really want to road test them good if you have one of these. That's the weak point of these cars. They're automatic transmissions. And interestingly enough, Mazda's kind of the opposite of other car companies. Most car companies are getting worse over time. They're making their cars cheaper. Mazda, with their relationship with Toyota the last decade or two, they're actually making them somewhat better. The new Mazda automatic transmissions are infinitely superior to these older ones. The 4-speed automatic that comes with these things is notorious for being sluggish. They are relatively slow. But this is a subcompact economy car.
It actually has quite a bit of room inside. You can see the back seat has a reasonable amount of space.
As a compromise, yeah, this thing is never going to go 440,000 miles like the Honda I checked out the other day and still ran like a clock. Let's see what this thing does with 180,000 miles on it.
We'll start it up. Starts right up. We'll roll the windows up so it's quiet. The windows still work. And when you put it in gear, it really doesn't shake much at all. She whines that the brakes have squeaked ever since she's owned it. Let's see what happens. Well, they didn't squeak then. Let's see if they squeak going forwards. No, but I heard a little squeak earlier. That's no big deal. That's just the brake pad material. You could put Acabona brake pads, it wouldn't make any noise at all. Now for a subcompact car. Since it's small, relatively light, they do handle quite well. Before, Mazda had their Zoom Zoom campaign, but it still is kind of zippy and fun to drive around in. The AC's still working fine, as are the brakes. They didn't squeak there either, so I wouldn't even care about that. The main thing we're checking out on this baby is that transmission. We're gonna take it out on the road. First, we'll drive slow and see how it shifts. Just normal driving. That shifted nice and smooth. We're going up a hill. It should shift again. It shifted very smooth. This transmission is still in excellent shape. Now, like I said, they're not rocket burners. Here's what it accelerates from zero. Here we go. Makes a lot of noise, but even under high RPM, the transmission still shifts smoothly. This 4-speed automatic with overdrive actually is in excellent shape. It was generally earlier Mazdas that had a lot of problems with the JATCO transmissions. But this, we'll see what happens when we downshift. It downshifted fine for better acceleration. Now people whine that these things are slow. This isn't that slow. This isn't that different than a Toyota Corolla. A little bit slower than a Honda Civic, but bought this thing for $8,000, 20 something thousand. She's put 160 something thousand on it. It still works perfectly fine. So I'm gonna get out the computer and see if she should hang on to it and use it for her big trips from Kentucky to Nashville every day for her new job. Now while I'm driving at highway speeds, I don't hear any bearings roaring, no odd noises, it goes straight, doesn't pull one way or the other. So we'll get the old Nova scan tool out. It's now getting all the information from the VIN number. And we'll do a custom scan. Now while we're waiting for that, I'm not usually a fan of buying from a rental car company. She bought this from Hertz, but it only had 25,000 miles, and really, how much damage can somebody do the first 25,000 miles? As long as they don't smash into things, most cars are gonna make it through that small amount of mileage without damage. But it's got two failed miles. modules. Let's see what they are. It's got a card for fuel pressure regulator control solenoid and intake manifold tuning valve control circuit open. Basically things you can ignore in this car as it aged. None of the systems work perfectly. The intake manifold tuning, maybe it's a little off sticking or something. Of course it will in an old car, but it runs fine. She gets normal gas mileage on it. As they age, those extra added things won't work perfectly all the time, but the car is still perfectly safe for using. Let's look at the live data. And here we go. Short-term fuel trim. It's zero. Minus 1.6. That's pretty good for an old car. Zero is perfect, right? The long-term fuel trim, 0.8. That's almost perfect, too. This thing is in immaculate shape. In terms of efficiency, this thing is running fuel trim about the same as a brand new car, even though it has 186,000 miles on it. So in this case, looks can be deceiving. Yeah, the hubcaps are gone, paint's fading away, got a big old ding in the back, but reliability-wise, she'd be nuts to get rid of this and buy an expensive, either new or overpriced used car. She's doing a long commute from Kentucky to Nashville and back. Highway mileage is equivalent to 10% city. This thing obviously has a lot of highway mileage on it, because I've seen these Mazdas with city mileage. 80, 100,000 miles of transmissions invariably crap out. This one still shifts like a dream. And the way it looks, hey, nobody's gonna wanna steal it, right? So don't be deceived by looks. This car still runs like a brand new car. Even though it's that old, 186,000 miles on it. It still runs good. It's a very dependable car. And these times of inflated prices, that's what you want. Don't go out and buy something else. This thing can go for years. Don't waste your money on an expensive car you don't need. I would not get rid of this car. It wouldn't make any sense. Honda box car, yes. Not that much power, yes. Okay gas mileage, 26, 28 miles a gallon on the highway, not great, but trade-off. You don't get an even trade-off if you get a car that, say, gets 35 miles a gallon and get rid of this. You're gonna pay a ton for that car. This thing's been paid for a long time ago. Got a lot of life left. And here's some bonus questions and answers. The realist boy Jay says, Scotty, I'm 17 and I'm looking for my first car. I really like this 09 Lexus GS350 with 180,000 miles for $6,000 from another person. What do you think? And do I absolutely positively have to put premium gas in it? It'll run perfectly fine on regular gas. You just lose a little bit of horsepower. But you're 17 and you want to get a Lexus with 180,000 miles. They're excellent cars, but realize everything eventually wears out. That is a very, very expensive car to repair when it does wear out. I know you're 17, but I think your eyes are bigger than your pocketbook. Because you're looking at a nice luxury vehicle. You're only 17. Bought a car when I was 17. I paid $500 for it. And it did have a bashed-in fender they had to fix, but you're taking a gamble there. You might look a little bit lower, like a used Camry or something. But you go ahead and get it. They're well-made cars, but realize if something breaks, it's going to cost some serious money. With that kind of mileage on it, eventually something's going to break on it, and the maintenance on it is going to be a lot higher than a 17-year-old is probably going to want to spend. Maybe look at little Hondas and stuff. They're really well-built, and they're a lot cheaper to fix. Gibby95 says, my AC isn't working right, and I have PO300 code. I got an 07 Chevy Aveo. I recharge the Freon, but it won't blow cold. It blows slightly colder air than outside when moving, but when it stopped, it's hot. I also got the code PO300. Right after putting in a new CPU, let's start out with the logical thing. You own a Chevy Aveo, one of the worst cars ever made. I believe they're made in Korea somewhere. They're really not made by Chevy. You know, they're cheaply made little cars. As for the AC, you put Freon in and it doesn't blow unless you move. There are so many things can go wrong. You said you put it in. It might have too much now, which actually makes it worse. Start by taking it to a guy like me, have him evacuate the AC, suck everything out, fill it with a factory load and pray it works. If it doesn't, you could spend a lot of money. It could be the compressor. It could be tons of things. Now, PO300 is intermittent misfire. Zillion things can do that. Change the air filter, the fuel filter, and the spark plugs and pray it goes away. Because if it doesn't, those things, the head gaskets can go on them. You didn't say how many miles you have them, but those little bitty junker engines that are in those, they only last so long. So let's say you got 170,000 miles. It's probably on its last legs. And it could be the head gasket starting to blow many different things. But start with the simple stuff, a tune-up. Have a guy evacuate the AC, fill it up, and then see what happens. Pray it's not the compressor going out or it's not the engine going out. If it's the engine going out, get rid of it. Don't put any money into that pile of junk. Rebuilding an engine is 3-4 times what the car's worth.
So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.